Now, if you were going to watch, going to Lord's this week to watch the cricket, you would have paid for a ticket. You would have taken some cash or used your debit card or whatever, and you would have paid for a ticket. And when you get to the ground, you hand the ticket over and they let you in. What actually makes the entrance possible is the payment for the ticket. But you don't get into the ground without the ticket. You with me? Okay, let's think about our lives. Jesus has paid the price for you and for me to be in relationship with God. Amen. On the cross, he died. He laid down his life so that we can know relationship with God. He laid down his life so that the things that we've done wrong that separate us from God can be cleansed away, can be forgiven, and we can find relationship with God. He paid the price. But it's very clear that on Judgment Day, and more about Judgment Day in the next couple of verses, it is required that there is evidence of the changed life that our relationship with God has made possible.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
We looked at 1 Thessalonians before. If you've missed that, you'll find it on our website. All the parts of that that are there. You'll remember that Paul, with Silas and Timothy, had planted the church. They'd had to leave prematurely because of some major opposition to Paul. And 1 Thessalonians was written shortly after that. We don't know how long the gap was between 1 Thessalonians and 2 Thessalonians. There's nothing in the letter or elsewhere in the New Testament that enables us to give it a precise date, nor do we know exactly what led to this second letter. There's nothing that tells us that either. From the letter itself, two things seem to have happened since 1 Thessalonians. There are some, by the way, I should mention, who've argued that in fact 2 Thessalonians was written first and 1 Thessalonians written after. There's a number of people that think that. I'm not convinced by that, so we'll assume they're the way round that they are in the Bible. It seems that the persecution that the church was experiencing had got more intense, and there are a number of references to that, some of which we're going to look at this morning. But it's also clear, and we'll see this morning, that the believers had grown in their walk with God. In 1 Thessalonians, there are a number of things that Paul prays for the church in Thessalonica. This morning, we'll see him giving thanks that those prayers have been answered. So it's been two developments. Their social context has got more difficult, but their walk with God has got stronger. And we're going to look at the whole of the first chapter this morning as we begin this new series. And I'd like to encourage you, as I encouraged you with 1 Thessalonians, to do the same thing with 2 Thessalonians. In this, when you get a letter from someone, you read it all the way through in one go, don't you? You don't just sort of read a couple of paragraphs and think, oh, next week I'll read another couple of paragraphs. You actually read the thing all the way through. And as you read it through, the whole thing hangs together in a way that bit by bit doesn't. Yeah? So, you can guess what I'm going to ask you now. I'd like you, if possible, before next Sunday, to make yourself a cup of tea, cup of hot peppermint, or glass of cold water, whatever you want, and to read just the three chapters of 2 Thessalonians in one go. It's only 2 pages, so it's not a lot to read. And I'm going to ask you next Sunday, probably, whether you've done it. So there's your homework. Is that okay? Do you agree with that? Is that reasonable? Yes. If I put effort into preparing for next Sunday, you're going to put some effort in as well. Does that seem fair? We'll see how fair it is next Sunday, shall we? Okay, let's begin with chapter 1 and, not surprisingly, beginning at verse 1. Paul, Silas and Timothy, to the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace and peace to you from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The beginning of 2 Thessalonians is very similar to the start of 1 Thessalonians. And I'm going to make some points now which I made at the beginning of 1 Thessalonians, which some of you may not remember, so it's worth saying again. Just notice the way that this letter comes from a team. It's one of the things about the New Testament. You find, wherever you look, you find teams of people. So here, this letter's from Paul, Silas and Timothy. Whenever you see people doing ministry in the New Testament, it is teams of people doing stuff. It's the normal pattern that is there. Which is why within the church family here all the time we're trying to create teams of people that are doing things. Not just one person, not just an individual, but teams of people. Because they share the work together, they bring a variety of gifts together. It also means that nothing is dependent upon one person. We all grow together, so really into teams. The word church is really interesting here, the way that it's used. To the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father. Why it's so interesting is this, is the word that was used for church here, it's the Greek word ekklesia, and it was a word that was used in everyday language. It wasn't a special word. It was an ordinary word that was used all the time, and it was used for any gathering or assembly of people. So, you know, so if you called your neighbourhood watch together, for example, they had neighbourhood watches in Thessalonica, I'm not sure, but it would be called the church, the gathering. That's exactly the same word. When the political leaders met together, it was the same word that was used. It was called the gathering. When they brought the whole of the town together, it was called the gathering. When they had and the fishing club met or whatever, you know, you get the point here. That was the common word, the ordinary word that was used every time. It was just the gathering. It wasn't a special word. So look how it's used here. To the gathering of the Thessalonians in God our Father. Not the gathering to consider the neighbourhood watch. Not the gathering to consider the politics of the city. But the gathering of people from Thessalonica in God the Father. I asked this question before, but I think it's an important question, so I'm going to ask it again. Now, when we think about this morning, as we've come here this morning, we call this, some people would call this building a church. I don't like, it's not actually a church. The building is made of bricks, church is made of people. We can call it a church building if we like, but this stuff you see around here is not church. What you see sitting on the seats, this is church. Good morning. So we are church. So we are the people from, our building here is on a boundary. So we are the people from Greenford, some of us from North Holt, some from Southall, some from Hayes, probably a few from farther away as well. But basically people from that area who are this morning in God the Father. Here. So when we think about what we're doing here as gathering together from the local area in God the Father, how do you think that might change or affect the way that we think about being here this morning? Do you understand the question? You know, we talk about, some people would talk about, are you going to church this morning? I don't like that phraseology, actually. Because it's about actually taking my bit of the church along to meet with the other bits of the church. You know, it's not going to church, though it's something over there. Actually, we are gathering together. We are church, gathering together in God the Father. How do you think that affects the way that we think about our time of being together? What do you think? My, it's gone very quiet. I should explain to you, if you're a visitor here, by the way, that I stop at various points during the teaching and we do some discussion together. So this is a part of that. But this bit of discussion's not going terribly well at the moment. But John, could you make a way for me to get down that side, Mr. PA man, please? It's just I can't get past there at the moment. So
I think if we feel that we're going to church, then it's something that's separate from us that we're then going to join on to. But if we see ourselves as a part of the church going to give to the rest, then we're connected, and therefore we'll bring something with us.
Very good. So we're bringing stuff along with us when we come together. Yeah.
It's like meeting with a family. If you're going to visit the family, you think of what can I take, what can I share, how can I encourage someone, and it's like meeting with a family.
Very good. So it's about not what we go to get, it's also what we go to give. Denzel, I think I saw your hand. Excuse me, John.
Just the words "in God our Father" means we have a common purpose for coming together and a common focus. No matter where we come from, whether it's Hazel or Greenford or wherever, but that commonality of experience and focus.
Yeah, very good. And we come to a common destiny. We come to be together in God our Father. One of the people I read this week, a guy called Wanamaker, delights in the name of Wanamaker. He's got this wonderful phrase about the church. I really like this. God is the origin and the domain or the place where it should live out its life. I really like that. God is the origin, it's where we come from in God, and it's the place where we live out our life. The second thing that's striking about this is grace and peace to you from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when we get further into the letter, you'll find that actually they are having a really difficult time. And so this phrase, peace to you from God the Father, is hugely striking, given the difficulties that they were facing. They were at this point in time facing persecution, more of that later on in this morning and later in the letter. And in the middle of that, Paul says to them, peace, peace to you. Reminds us that even in extreme difficulties, we can know God's peace. And I wondered as I was thinking about this morning whether there might be one or two of you that want to very briefly testimony about when life has been extremely difficult for you, that right in the middle of that you have known God's peace. I'm sure for all of us there'll be different stories, but just one or two. Time when life has been really difficult, you've known God's peace. Caleb.
Yeah, I mean, some people here know that I'm going through a very, very difficult time at the moment. But just over the last sort of 3 or 4 weeks, God has really strengthened me and given me a real sense of peace, vision and guidance as to where I should be going and what I should be doing, and really sort of brought me down to earth, back into his love and his kingdom, and shown me a clear vision of where I should be. And it's just amazing how he's helped me through a very, very difficult time, and just relying on him has made things so much easier. It's brilliant, you know, just praise him for that.
Right, thank you, Caleb. One other? Yeah, Tia.
God's peace is so vital, especially when you go through a lot of problems, and God will refocus, give you something to refocus more greater than what you have. Can't explain it. It's like your problem is nothing compared to someone else. So he will always put you to do good thing for others so that you can see his power.
Okay, and I'm not going to go into the details, but I know that for you there have been a number of periods of time at Tio when life has been very, very difficult. But in the midst of that, there is this knowledge of God's peace. We ought, says Paul, always to thank God for you brothers, and rightly so, because your faith is growing more and more, and the love every one of you has for each other is increasing. Therefore, among God's churches, we boast about your perseverance and faith in all the persecutions and trials you are enduring. Just remind ourselves of what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians. Let me just read a few verses to you from chapter 3. In verse 2, he says, "We sent Timothy to strengthen and encourage you in your faith." In verse 5, "For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter might have tempted you, and our efforts have been useless." Verse 10, "Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith." Verse 12, "May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you." So all of this was his hope and prayer for the Thessalonians. And now he's saying, we thank God because your faith is growing more and more, and the love every one of you has for each other is increasing. It's a great picture of church, isn't it? What a testimony. Paul's so excited about it that he's saying to all the other churches, have you heard what's happening in the Thessalonians, in Thessalonica, the church there? They're having a really hard time. Yet, in the midst of that, their faith is growing more and more, and the love that everyone has for each other is increasing. He's not boasting about what they have achieved. He's boasting about what God has done in them, God's work in their lives. It's God's work, not their own achievement. That phrase that he uses there, we're going to come back to faith a little bit later on. But here it talks about the love every one of you has for each other. The love that every one of you who's a part of the gathering, the church in Thessalonica, has for each other. What do you think that looks like? What do you think Paul saw among the Thessalonians? What sort of things? Or maybe let's think about ourselves. If Paul was looking at Greenford Baptist Church here today, and he was looking to see whether it was true that the love that every one of us has for each other is increasing, what sort of things would he be wanting to see, do you think, in our lives, in our church family life here? What sort of things show that the love every one of you has for each other is increasing? I can see that hand. I'm on my way. Fiona.
Over the past couple of months, I've received, I've gone forward for prayer a few times, and I've had the support of Exodus and my prayer triplet, and it's just shown so much love. And all I've had is a continued love and support from everybody in this building. And there have been people praying for this situation that I wasn't even aware of for doing it. And, you know, that's one of the things. It's like there are loads of people who have a similar story of saying, I was going through a tough time and people were praying and I didn't even know they were praying for me.
Right. Thank you. Anybody else? Susan.
And I can back that up, because when we came here in 2004 and the church, the amazing love that the church reached out from every angle, every person helped the family. And that I will never forget about Greenford Baptist Church was the amazing love. And just their support was just tremendous for me as a mother.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else? So let's move past the introduction into the body of the of this opening part of the letter, which is in some ways a little bit like an overture to what is coming later in what is actually quite a short letter, as you say, just three chapters. All this, says Paul, is evidence that God's judgment is right. And as a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. All of this, says Paul, is evidence that God's judgment is right, and as a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. Now, when you first read this verse, as I first read this verse thinking about this morning, earlier this week, it's a bit puzzling what Paul is going on about here. How is it that the believer's suffering is evidence that God's judgment is right? And let me explain that for a few minutes. Let's explore that together. Throughout the New Testament, there is a close link between suffering and difficulty and God's glory. And it goes back to the life of Jesus. I've told you before about a friend of mine who wrote a book. It was a book of testimony poems, and he entitled it, "The Way to Up is Down." The way to up is down. And we see that in Jesus' life. How was it that Jesus ended up ascended to the right hand of the Father? Because he actually laid down his life and died on the cross. And not just died on the cross, but on the cross was separated from his Father. There is that pattern it talks about elsewhere in the New Testament, that our lives, because we are Christians, and the word Christian literally means little Christs. It's the diminutive of Christ, little Christs. And our life is patterned after Jesus. Doesn't mean it's exactly the same, but there is a similar pattern. And for Jesus, the way to glory was through difficulty and through suffering. And it is the same for us. So you take that a step on. So if a person is growing in faith during hard times, Caleb talked a few minutes ago about the hard times that he is experiencing at the moment. And the way that he is growing in God in those times. That is evidence that God is at work in Caleb's life. So it's evidence that God's judgment about Caleb is right. Because he's having difficulty, yet he's growing in God. There is a sense here, and I'm going to step back from this sense in a moment and explain it differently. It's a bit like persevering in God, even when things are difficult, is like a badge that gives admission to heaven. Now, we need to understand that quite carefully, because it might sound like that we can somehow earn our way into heaven, and that is absolutely not true. And one of the writers I read this week, a guy called Beale, he tells, in the way he tells it, quite a long story, but in essence it's this. He likens this to the way you get into a sporting event. Now, if you were going to watch... going to Lord's this week to watch the cricket, you would have paid for a ticket. You would have taken some cash or used your debit card or whatever, and you would have paid for a ticket. And when you get to the ground, you hand the ticket over and they let you in. What actually makes the entrance possible is the payment for the ticket. But you don't get into the ground without the ticket. You with me? Okay, let's think about our lives. Jesus has paid the price for you and for me to be in relationship with God. Amen. On the cross, he died. He laid down his life so that we can know relationship with God. He laid down his life so that the things that we've done wrong, that separate us from God, can be cleansed away, can be forgiven, and we can find relationship with God. He paid the price. But it's very clear that on Judgment Day, and more about Judgment Day in the next couple of verses, it is required that there is evidence of the changed life that our relationship with God has made possible. You know the parable of the sheep and goats, don't you, in Matthew's Gospel? And in that story, as Jesus tells the story, the difference between those that end up spending eternity with our Heavenly Father and those that are cast into the outer darkness is actually about what they've done in their lives, in the context that Jesus lays out in that story. And you find that elsewhere. You see, I don't think it is possible for someone to be in a genuine relationship with God and their lives not to be changed. I don't think that's possible. With the power of the Holy Spirit inside us, with the process of transformation that goes on in us, with the life of God in us, I don't think it's possible for someone to come in relationship with God and for their life not to be changed. I recognize that that's a process that doesn't happen instantly. I recognize that it takes time. In fact, it goes on through the whole of our life here. More of that a bit later this morning. So Jesus pays the price, but it is the evidence of that in our lives that needs to be seen. And so Paul went on to say this in verse 6. God is just. He will pay back trouble to those who trouble you and give relief to you who are troubled, and to us as well. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. He will punish those who do not know God and do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with everlasting destruction and shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the majesty of his power. On the day he comes to be glorified in his holy people and to be marveled at among all those who believed, this includes you because you believed our testimony to you. Well, this is about Judgment Day. And the image here is of Jesus revealed from heaven in blazing fire. And again, the blazing fire is, as so often in these images, is symbolic. It doesn't mean that as Jesus comes back, you know, there's going to be this trail of flames coming out from behind him and smoke and all of that sort of stuff. It's a picture. It's a symbol. It's an image. Have a lot more of those when we look at the book of Revelation, starting in a little while. It's an image, it's a symbol, it stands for something else. And it's a symbol of God's holiness. It points to his holiness. And it points to the fact that God's holiness does not tolerate sin and destroys sin. And it points also that this event's not going to happen in a corner. This isn't going to be a quiet thing. When Jesus came into the world last time, you could have missed it. If you didn't happen to notice a star, meet a few shepherds, spot a few angels, you could have missed it. Very quiet. Most people in our world didn't know that the Saviour of the world had been born in a stable. They didn't know. When Jesus returns, it will not be possible not to know. The Bible's very clear. Every eye will see. This isn't going to be done in a corner. This isn't a quiet thing. This is, or as John Stott puts it, awe-inspiring cosmic splendor. This is going to be a massive event. And an event that's going to have significance for everyone who has ever lived. Not just those who are alive, but everyone who has ever lived and has previously died. This day will have significance for them. And it's a day when human beings will be divided into two groups, as in that parable of the sheep and of the goats. And some will go to a destiny that is permanent separation from God. You see, for those who've chosen to live their lives apart from God, their destiny will be to live eternally excluded from God's presence, eternally excluded from God's power, eternally excluded from any possibility of relationship with God. And this is going to be torment. It's talked about it here, it's talked about elsewhere. It's going to be torment because what they previously had chosen to ignore in terms of who God is, of what Jesus has done, and of God's love, they will see at Judgment Day. But because they have chosen to live separate from God, their eternal destiny will be separation from God. For those who've caused trouble to believers, says Paul here, they will experience trouble. People will get what they have chosen. And I want to remind us that separation from God is permanent separation from God, is a grim and dreadful reality. And it's a destination that many people in our world alive today are heading towards. Which is why, for example, last Saturday, or part of the reason last Saturday, as we heard testimonies earlier on this morning, we have people out on the streets telling people about God's love. Because we want everyone to have the opportunity of coming into relationship with God, of knowing God's love, of knowing God's care, of knowing that the creator and sustainer of the universe loves them, has a purpose for them, and wants the best for their lives. We want every person that is alive to know God's love at work in them, changing them, transforming them. We want every person to end up eternity with God. We would like hell to be an empty destination. We don't want anybody to go there. And so we want to share God's love with people because we want everyone to enjoy and share what we have found in God and the life-transforming power of God in us. Amen.
Amen.
For some, on Judgment Day, that day when Jesus returns personally, visibly, bringing this world as it is now to an end. God's holy people, to quote John Stott again, I just like his turn of phrase with this. He says, God's holy people will be transformed by his splendor. They will become vehicles by which it is displayed. This involves a radical and permanent change, being transformed into his likeness. We who all our lives have been, says John Stott, pathetic apologies for human beings, will at last be fully human and fully free and fully Christ-like. One of the writers this week, I'm not sure that I go all the way with this imagery, but he says that, you know, we human beings are like light bulbs. And he talks about the old filament light bulbs. He says, we're just like light bulbs. And, but there will come a day when God's glory will so flow through us that rather than just being a disconnected light bulb, we will reflect the radiance and glory of God. I don't go all the way with the image, but there is an element of truth in that. These are the destinations, permanent destinations, separation from God, radical and permanent change, being transformed into his likeness, becoming completely and totally 100% all that God made us to be. So here's the question, which we're going to take a few minutes to think about here. This is the reality. Judgment Day is coming. We don't know when that's going to be. We know that we should be living, aware that it could be any day. And Paul is saying this here to the Thessalonians, not just to give them a lesson about the future. Paul is saying this to the Thessalonians, and God is saying this to us this morning, because this has impact today, in our lives, today. Amen? So, what is this about in our lives? What does this mean for us? How should this reality of Jesus' return and of the judgment day that is that event, how should that affect how we live now? There's a whole range of answers to this, but let's just pull some of them together. How should this affect how we live now? How you live, how I live, today, tomorrow, this week. What do you think? Carol?
We should keep on and more and more submitting to God's word in our lives and letting his word transform, being obedient to it and letting that transform us, and we'll just keep fighting that internal fight.
Yeah, good. What else? Yes, Matt.
I believe transformation starts from the very first minute we receive Jesus and we start to submit our life to him, and this process accomplished when he returns back.
Okay, yeah. So, Ismat, how does that affect, you're going to work tomorrow?
Yeah, sure.
How does that affect, how does that reality affect you tomorrow, Monday morning, when you go to work?
It's an everyday decision. Either I live to myself or I live to Christ. How I show Christ to the people around me. And not to show them that, oh, I'm a Christian, but to just be an open always and Christ work through me.
Thank you. Yeah. Steve.
Yeah, I mean, this whole transformation is important. And the most important thing is that, to me, is there's people around us who are basically dying and they need to know the truth, and we're there for them to transfer, to share.
So how does that affect you tomorrow, Steve?
Who does God want me to speak to tomorrow? And that's how it affects me. Who do you want me to speak to tomorrow about you, Father, so that they can know about you? That's how it affects me tomorrow.
Thank you. Anne.
I think it's just to be an encouragement to those people around you when everybody around you feeling the stress of the day and the things that's going around in their lives at work, is for you to say to them is that God is with you, and for you to just trust in God. And I think that's one of the things that I try to do at work, to talk to people and say, don't worry about that. It may not look right. It may not feel right, but God is there.
Okay. Thank you. What else?
For me, it's to strive to live one day at a time, serving my God, reading his word, studying his word, walking close to God. And also what I know of God is to really have the desire to share with others, So when the Lord comes, he's going to ask me, my faithful servant, what have you done? Who have you brought with? And that I have shared what I have for God. I've shared it with others because that's the love I have for him. I don't want to see my brethren not enter heaven. So it's my duty as a Christian to share that. But I've got to get my life first with God before I do that.
Okay, thank you. One day.
When I was listening to you, I just felt that it emphasized the point that this life is not really for us. It's for us to like completely die to ourselves and to live every day for God. And we've all been put in different circumstances and different lines of work for a reason. It's not just to kind of like get money and live every day just as everyone else does. It's actually to make a real difference in the world and just to actually have God actively working through us. Because I think that sometimes you get so carried away just thinking, oh yeah, my exams is for me and medical degrees is for me, but it really isn't. It's for me to help other people and to show God's love to other people. But yeah, that's put it in perspective really.
Great. Thank you. Let's come on to these last couple of verses that we're going to look at this morning. With this in mind, so with the reality of Jesus' return, with this in mind, we constantly pray for you, says Paul, that our God may count you worthy of his calling, and that by his power, he may fulfill every good purpose of yours, and every act prompted by your faith. We pray this so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we hear an awful lot today about self-image and a lot about the harmful effect that a poor self-image can have on people. And it strikes me as I read these verses here, that the source of our self-image for us who are Christians should be the reality that Jesus is going to be glorified in us. You know, we are not worthy of God's love. We're not worthy of what God does in us. But our image, in fact, is the image of God in us. And rather than beating ourselves up about what we think about ourselves, we should understand that our self-image is the reality that Jesus will be glorified in us. As Beale puts it this way, our worthiness lies in being vessels that can reflect his glory. That's our worthiness, that we can reflect the glory of the living God. The final quote for this week, John Stott again says this, and this is the context of what these verses are about here. God is working in us to narrow the gap between what we were when he called us and what we should be and shall be. God is working in us to narrow the gap between what we were when he called us and what we should be and shall be. What Ismat was saying, that God began at that point when we gave our lives to him. God began his work in us. That process of transformation began. And from now until the time that either Jesus returns or that we die, there is that ongoing process of transformation, becoming more and more, living out more and more all the potential that God has put in us, becoming all that God has created us to be. You know, Paul letting them know what he was praying for them is a great way of motivating them. Do you know that? Parents do that sometimes. When they're praying with their children. Yeah, some of you laugh, you know, don't you? When you're praying with your children, you pray, you know what God wants in them, but you pray for them and let them hear it. And you know that actually motivates them towards reaching for what God wants for them. Some of you here are also nodding. I know it's your parents been praying for you. You've heard it. Praying over you. It's what Paul is doing here. He's letting them know, I'm praying this for you. This is what God is going to do. I'm praying God for this. So the final question this morning, we talk a lot about God's glory, and it's a concept that, you know, there are all sorts of images around. But I wonder what it is to see God's glory in other people. What is it when we see in other people? It talks here about Jesus being glorified in us. What does it look like? You know, when we talk about glory, we've got images in our mind of fire and clouds and blazing trumpets and all those sorts of images from Exodus and from elsewhere. But what does it look like? We don't see it fully now, but we just see reflections of it. We see bits that we reflect of God's glory in other people's lives. What does it look like? What does it look like?
Dave?
Oh, just one word, basically, Jesus.
Jesus, okay.
Yeah. Birch?
For me, I think you can see the glow in the faces of people who really and truly trusted in Jesus and has him as their true Saviour and Lord. You see that glow in the faces.
Mm-hmm. What else? Fiona?
Random acts of kindness. Practical love being shown. It's going beyond the call of duty. It's walking, you know, offering to walk 1 mile and going two. It's being practical. It's not, glory is summed up as a spiritual idea in that, but in reality, the way we live now, it's a practical sign of love. It's being there. It's being Jesus in the situation, and Jesus is all about love, and so it's just showing love however it's needed to be shown in that situation.
Now, I know what a random act of kindness is, but I think a number of the people listening to this won't know what a random act of kindness is. Can you
Right,
explain
it's just
that?
Walking up to somebody and giving them a hug because the Holy Spirit's prompted you to do that. It's just giving a smile to somebody in the street. It's just being who you are to that person. It's being consistent in who you are as well. It's random acts of kindness is a buzzword going around the internet and stuff, and there's people doing it. It's a movement that is happening, but it's something that we as church should be doing anyway.
So it's just doing kind things for people for no reason than doing kind things
it's
for
not,
people.
It's not about you. It's totally about you want to do something nice for somebody and you just go ahead and do it. It's not because you want something back from it. It's because you want to do that.
Great. Thank you. Wendy.
The fruits of the Holy Spirit being evident in your life.
Do you want to list a few?
Yeah, I've got it here.
Ah.
I knew you were going to ask that. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And against such things, there is no law.
Great. Thank you, Wendy. You were going to say exactly the same thing. I'm sorry. You've had your thunder stolen, well and truly.
As look around you, you see different cultures, different ages, all mixing together, all in the same family because of Jesus. That's what it looks like to me.
Okay, and that's really important because so much in our world, there is so much division that is based on people being different, whether it's ethnicity or culture or skin colour or whatever else. And God's family, we are one. We're one family. We share the same Heavenly Father. We share the same likeness of God, and yet we are such a mixed bunch. And within the church family here, we have people from ethnic groups who in other contexts are actually in opposition to each other, but here they're brothers and sisters sharing the same family here. Liz.
That's basically what I was going to say, because in John 18, when Jesus is actually praying for us, as in the ones who will believe after the disciples' message, which is everyone here, he prays for unity, and he talks about the fact that he's given us his glory so that the unity would be in evidence and people would know that we are one in God and they would believe that Jesus was sent. So that's part of having his glory.
Fantastic. Thank you. So let's just begin to draw together. Our time has gone this morning. So main things that for me, as I've thought about this morning, three main things that come out of this passage for me. You know, even in extreme difficulty, when everything around us is falling apart, opposition coming our way, we can experience and know God's peace. Judgment Day is coming, and we will be, and it's an ongoing process. It's begun, it's continuing, but it will come to perfection, being transformed into His likeness. Let's stand together. And I want to give you a moment, stand if you're able to, I want to give you a moment to make your own response to God, and then I'm going to pray for us together. Father God, I want to thank you for sending Jesus into our broken and rotten world. Thank you that by laying down his life, he's made it possible for us to have relationship with you. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the reality of that. Thank you that you are at work in our world now, but thank you that you're not going to leave our world like this. There will come a day, Father God, we ask for soon, when Jesus will return, will bring this rotten world with its pain and with its suffering to an end. Thank you that we can be sure and confident that that day is coming. And Father, I want to ask us all this morning, as we are in that gap between the time when Jesus came for the first time and the time when he's going to return, Father God, as we live in that gap now, help us to be people who day by day are being transformed more and more into your likeness, whose lives more and more, day by day, reflect the kingdom of God, reflect your glory, Father, shining out through us, becoming all that you have created us to be, knowing your likeness, seeing it manifest through our lives. And Father, help us alongside that to have a renewed passion for telling people around us the good news about you. As we recognize that people are going to a place of separation from you, Father, help us to show them the alternative and the fact that you care for them and you love them and you want the best for them. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.